prostate cancer is still diagnosed by one of two ways. Number one is if we feel a bump or what we describe as a nodule on the prostate or something that feels irregular. It should feel pretty smooth, but if we feel an abnormality in that prostate, we have to figure out is could that be a focus of cancer. But the actual more common way that we find prostate cancer is by an elevated PSA. Okay, let's talk about the PSA. What is the PSA? The PSA is a blood test. It stands for prostate-specific antigen. And that chemical is actually released at very small amounts into the bloodstream. If we start seeing that that chemical and that antigen, that blood is actually a molecule is released at a higher rate, then we know that could there be something going on within that prostate? Well, it doesn't necessarily mean it's cancer. It could be infection, it could be inflammation, it could be that that patient just had instrumentation, it could be that they are unable to empty their bladder and they basically are peeing every 10 minutes because that bladder is just too full and it's irritating that prostate. So if you irritate the prostate, that could cause that PSA to be elevated. But one of those potential problems could potentially be, of course, prostate cancer. So the PSA, again, is a very important blood test. So what do we use? Well, in the old days, but I mean the old days before 2003, 2004, we used to use a cutoff of 4.0. And now, for lack of a better term, we use a cutoff of 2.5, even though there's no true cutoff. So a man can't walk into a urologist's office and say, I'm 2.6, and you know, most urologists won't say, well, you know, it looks like we got to do a prostate biopsy on you. It's all a question of relativity. So if a man walks in and he's 70 years old and his PSA is 2.7, I am going to be less concerned about that. And again, I would love to know what his PSAs have been running over the last 20 years. Very likely his PSA has risen very slightly. And for that man who's in his 70s, because that prostate has grown a little bit as he's aged, I'm less concerned with his PSA being in the 2.6, 2.7, even 3.0 range, give or take, you know, for that man, than I am in a man in his 40s. And for a number of different reasons. Again, a man in his 40s comes in and his PSA is 2.6. That man is young. He should have a relatively smaller prostate. And as a result, we should expect that PSA to be lower. So again, there's no true cutoff, but we start the conversation at, you know, somewhere in the ballpark of around 2.5 to 3.0 to let us know something is going on. What I tell men is that if a man walks into my office and his PSA, he's a younger man, let's say in his 40s, and his PSA is 1.7, you know, we're not giving high fives and saying, great man, you know, don't worry about it, it's all good. So we say, look, this PSA is elevated, you know, for where we are with this. And this is something that we have to follow very, very closely. We need to make sure that next year that PSA doesn't go up to 1.9 or even to 2.0. And some people even make the argument that a man with in his 40s with a PSA, you know, in the high ones, he actually has a potential risk of having a, you know, a higher focus of prostate cancer. So we talk about that. And that's the discussion you need to have with your urologist is, what do I do with this PSA? And the other challenge with this, which I'm going to throw in there, is the PSA will fluctuate. And that's the challenges. One of the most important things I tell men before they go to get their PSA drawn is no ejaculation. Ejaculation is one of the easiest things that can cause just a slight bump in that PSA, but it can affect things, you know, enough where you can basically raise an eyebrow to this. So I tell men, try to refrain from ejaculation for 24 to 48 hours before we do the PSA. Another myth which is associated with a PSA is if I get a rectal exam, that's going to affect my PSA. So my doctor does a rectal exam and he says, all right, well now I want to get a PSA. And so men will say, well, you can't do that because you just did a rectal exam on me. Great studies out there that say that the chances that's going to affect that PSA is minuscule at best. Now again, if a man walks in and I do a prostate massage where I'm pushing on that prostate for 30 seconds, yeah, I get that. That's going to potentially affect that PSA. But for a majority of the times, if we're just doing a regular prostate exam, the chances that's going to affect that PSA significantly is extremely low. So we don't need to worry about that. But again, that PSA, we've got to get the PSA. We've got to know that that PSA is normal, or at least within those ranges that we would follow very closely. And also that rectal exam to make sure we're not feeling any bumps on that prostate.
Some prostate cancers are high risk, aggressive, and more likely to spread. Others are low risk, least likely to have bad outcomes. The biopsy says cancer, but current diagnostic tools provide limited information about how aggressive a man's individual disease is. So most men decide to treat prostate cancer immediately. Once treated, many men experience serious long-term side effects, like incontinence and sexual impotence. Immediate treatment isn't always needed. But right now, a man can't be sure if his cancer is the kind that is likely to require treatment or if he's okay to wait for now. What if there was a test that could determine how aggressive prostate cancer is? Genomic Health is developing a new test to do just that. By reviewing the underlying biology of the tumor and using genes from multiple biologic pathways, the test can predict the aggressiveness of prostate cancer when diagnosed, allowing a man to make a more informed treatment decision with confidence, taking care of himself with more information and greater peace of mind.